Professor Ruth Wisse, thank you so much for taking the time to join us here at the Jewish Leadership Conference with the Tikvah Fund. Very well-received speech today about who is the American Jewish hero. Talk us through this speech you gave today, the premise behind it, and why it's so important, and why you felt it was so well-received here.
Well, it's a good question. I guess that my starting point was really something that has been on my mind for a very long time, and that is really, you know, the way in which Shalom Aleichem, in that generation of Yiddish and Hebrew writers at the turn of the century, struggled with the question of who is a hero, who is the Jewish hero. And, you know, they were writing books and novels generally have a hero of some kind, and they wanted to know who this could be, and they had a lot of trouble finding him. Who could it be? And the reason that Jewish life has trouble with it is because our idea of the hero is obviously not the Western hero. He's not the great lover of the Romantic tradition. He's not the great warrior, not the great statesman. He's not a cardinal. So Jewish life had plenty of very wonderful people, but when it came to writing books about them, they didn't know who this was. So Shalom Aleichem really has this great theme. And so that's one of the things I started with in this talk. And his theme, in a strange way, turns out to go back to his childhood, where I think that he discovers that he is very close to the idea of Ben Zoma, who says, who is a hero? The man who stifles his urge or his passion. Now, that's a very hard teaching, right? Because why should people stifle their urges? Well, the way Shalom Aleichem begins to work this out as a creative writer is to write about the fact that as a child, he had to give up certain things, like the penknife that he was never allowed to play with. And he makes a virtue of it, despite the fact that the story is tragic, painful, and that he has to suffer in giving it up. He writes this story, which is then published as a story for children, by the way, although that's not the way in which it was originally written. He writes this in order to reaffirm this idea, which then, when he begins to write about Tevye from his perspective as a parent, is flipped on its head. It's still the same theme, but now it's not the father who has to tell the child to give something up. It's written from the perspective of the father, who is now being asked by his daughters to give in to all their desires. So one daughter wants to marry a person whom he thinks is not right. He gives in to her. The other one wants to run off with a revolutionary because she herself is very much impassioned with these ideas of the revolution. He gives in to her. So we begin to think that, the Jewish father is one who just accommodates, is a, you know, a traditional father, but he goes along with whatever his daughter. But then, interestingly, the third daughter is Chava, in by far the most gripping of these stories. She converts to marry a Ukrainian, which in that time, of course, you could not marry unless you converted. And she wants her father to accept her as she is. And Tevye does not. He sits shiva for her, and he will not accept her in any way. It's not that he doesn't struggle with it, and the struggle, as Shalom Aleichem writes about it, is one of the most moving passages in his work. But at the end he says no. And that chapter made a tremendous impression on his readers, because it was what many of them were experiencing, right? I mean, many, many Jews were converting at that time, and many of them thought nothing of it. They were converting just in order that they should be able to teach or that they should be able to enter. In any case, 8 years later, the edicts came that the Jews would have to leave those villages. And then Shalom Aleichem wrote a story about Tevye having to leave the village. And at that point, in that story, he has Chava leave her husband and come back and ask to be accepted by her father. And at that point, Tevye does accept her again when she has left her husband. Now, what I say, among other things in this talk, is that Fiddler on the Roof is really one of the great American musicals. Obviously, it was done from the point of view of the writers as a tribute to Shalom Aleichem and to Tevye and all the rest of it. But at the end of Fiddler on the Roof, it doesn't end the way Shalom Aleichem ended. It ends in the opposite way, that the Ukrainian son-in-law, now the husband, and Chava decide that they are going to leave when the Jews are expelled. And they say, we cannot stay here under these conditions when the Jews are being expelled. So we're going off to Krakow. Okay. But then Tevye doesn't react. So Chvedka says to him, some drive away with edicts, and others drive off with silence. In other words, what he is saying is that the evil of the Tsar expelling the Jews from Russia is to be equated with Tevye's driving off his children with his silence. Now, is that how we see it? Well, that is how the liberal imagination sees it, because they see that Judaism's desire for marriage within the Jewish family, the preservation of the Jewish people, which would have to mean marriage within the community. It couldn't be otherwise. Community can't sustain itself if people do not maintain Jewish families intact in some way. But from the liberal point of view of the Fiddler on the Roof writers, this is tantamount to expulsion. And that is the great masterpiece of the American Jewish theater. So this is something to contemplate. And one of the problems with it is that it happens so effortlessly that I don't think the writers ever gave it a thought. They just did it because this is the way America is. Liberalism expects everybody to intermarry. Liberalism does not have any concept of something like a Jewish people that has to stay intact. Now, by the way, the Jewish people is not the only. People in other religious traditions feel exactly the same way about maintaining themselves. But there is something that has entered the liberal imagination that has no longer any tolerance for separateness of any kind. They feel it as a threat. And this has been a great problem for the Jews in America. So I was just trying to bring that out into the open. And so my hero becomes the American Jewish father who really is expected to raise, first of all, to marry Jewish, perhaps a convert to Judaism, but to keep a Jewish family, and to raise a Jewish family. Now, this used to be the model of the Jewish patriarch, of the Jewish family. Well, we see what's happened to that model. First of all, to the model of manhood in America generally these days, and certainly to the model of a father who, you know, wants to keep families separate. Well, I'm trying to somehow revalidate that heroism.
So I'll ask you, you made the statement at the beginning of our talk that the traditional hero thought about in the West is not the traditional hero within Judaism. It's not thought about the same way. In your old stomping grounds at Harvard University, there was an editorial decision made lately, recently at the Harvard Crimson, to endorse the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement against Israel. There has been this thought lately in Israeli society that Israel has been looked upon too often by Western definitions. And in fact, Israel, like the Jewish people themselves, are in a hard scrabble part of the world where they have to fight for their survival on an everyday basis and shouldn't be looked upon with Western standards anymore, shouldn't be looked upon with a Western narrative, and should be looked upon in the context of where they are at the moment. Do you feel there's some sort of correlation there between the two?
Absolutely. That's very interesting. I think it's exactly the same issue. And it has to do with what your idea of toleration really is. If you have no toleration for differences, then you're really not the tolerant person you think you are. Liberalism is of two kinds. There is a liberalism that respects differentiation. That's the liberalism of the, let's say, the classic liberalism of the 19th century, that we consider ourselves classical liberals in that sense, is a liberalism that really respects religious differences, cultural differences, if they are within an acceptable tradition, right? Like the Noahide laws, right? For Judaism, that's no problem, because we always live among the nations. But liberalism, interestingly enough, sometimes loses that tolerance, and all it wants is to embrace the other. In that sense, it has something in common with the Christian idea that everybody has to become a Christian, or the Islamic idea that everybody has to become under the Muslims. Well, when liberalism becomes intolerant in that way, then of course it has no, then Israel becomes the primary enemy, because Israel is kind of the nation state par excellence. I mean, it is sort of such an amazing example of a people that could, in the 1940s, when one third of the people is destroyed, this same people could reclaim its sovereignty after 2,000 years in its own homeland and to defend it. I mean, this is a model of national self-liberation, of nationhood, which is extraordinary. And so, yes, it becomes kind of, when seen through Western eyes, it becomes not only dislikable, but it becomes kind of a dangerous force. This is really a model of separateness, and it is felt by some liberals to be antagonistic to them. Now, Israel is not antagonistic to them. It's not antagonistic to any of the surrounding Arab states. But the Arab states, you see, do not tolerate. They do not accept the principle of coexistence. The whole problem in the Middle East has been not of Israel, but that it is the representative of the principle of coexistence. Now, as soon as an Arab state accepts the principle of coexistence, its first act is to make peace with Israel.
Fascinating conversation today and fascinating speech you gave earlier. Thank you so much, Professor Ruth Wisse, for joining us here.
Thank you very much.